that the paramount thing in humanism and in all these ideas and worldviews that we hear out there, especially the pseudo-Christian ideas, are and focus on and always point back to self. Anything to justify self. Anything to get this old rotten hide
right.
out of having to deal with what
all right.
dirty laundry he's got to deal
That's
with.
That's right, bro.
Anything to do the rope-a-dope with God.
Yeah.
All the time they do the rope-a-dope. Then God's hitting them all the time.
Yeah.
And they're trying to duck, dodge, and hide. And it has everything to do with self-defense. Now, that's the paramount thing in humanism. That's the paramount thing in sinners and their excuses. That's the paramount thing in Joel and Billy Goat Graham and all these other people. It all has to do with a religion where I can be a part of it. And I get to make the rules and I get to be my own God.
Come on, preacher.
That's what it's talking.
Oh, yeah.
That's what it all comes back to. It never focuses on this. This is transcendent. It's outside of you and I. You can't explain any of this except Christ.
Come on.
It's outside of you and I. Now, he's in us and he's come to live in us, but it can only be explained when they're marshaling all their intellect out on campus and they're trying to wax rhetorical and they're coming with these nice regurgitated little things. I asked a girl today, you know, the testimonies go on and on and on. Well, if this is a book of lies, what is the standard you're using to measure this book of lies from?
Come on now.
Give me a standard. Where are you starting? Well, it sounds to me like you're starting right here with you.
Oh, yeah.
With self. And it's your own. Now, the sister, your wife back here, I heard her say a word when you alluded to something here, and it has to do with this, is the word scary. When you depend on, you know, I'm not going to depend on fallible man. I'm not going to depend on something, amen, that has proven to be fallible and inconsistent and proven to fail.
Come on.
I think, I feel. That's a dangerous place to start.
Yeah.
Dangerous. And we see the product of that. The paramount thing in Christianity is not self-reliance, but it's self-denial.
Yeah.
It's no longer I, but it's Christ that lives in me.
Right.
Amen? And so the last thing that's always hard to die, it is self.
Mm-hmm.
It's the hardest thing. And so we want to look at this here tonight. We can talk and preach and teach about the finer points of open-air evangelism. We can talk to the crowd, the apologetics and the apologeticos. We're answering their questions. These are all good tools we take out of our pouch. Amen. But if we miss this, we've got a miry place in our heart. That has not been dealt with. Amen. I've seen it over the short course of 12 years. Men leave the altar of prayer. They leave reliance on Christ. They leave the book of God. Amen. And they carry on like nothing has ever happened. Their kingdom is now jeopardized. They're caught in sin. And what are they doing? They're rationalizing. It all comes back to self-defense. A recurring theme among fallen preachers. I thought I was an exception.
Come on.
We reprove, we rebuke, we exhort. Amen. And we should. But how is it with us? The nucleus, amen, of the gospel, amen, of all ministry. I don't care if you're a pastor, if you're a campus preacher, if you're a missionary, street, whatever it is, if you're just a housewife, doesn't matter, amen. The whole point of 613 laws, amen, to the children of Israel, the whole point of 10 commandments, the whole crimson thread through the Old Testament, the sacrifices, the miracles. The brother talked about the temple a little bit. That brazen, everything that had to do with typology in the old, all the way into the new, right from creation, where he told them not to eat of that forbidden fruit. He told them that the whole point was there was submission and obedience to God's authority. Amen. And so this, amen, the idea, the sort of the nucleus is, God's trying to get this from a stony heart into a flesh, from stony tablets, rather, to a fleshly heart. That's what he's trying to do. And so, does God have my heart? Does God have your heart?
Come on, Brother Matt.
Let's talk to us. We talk to them.
Yeah.
Let's talk to us a little bit. Jesus said, depart, I never knew you. We read the scripture already. Amen. The great commandment, always, the great commandments always precede, amen, the great commission. You never put the great commission before the great commandment. And the first one, and the two that are summed up, we know them by heart. To love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the love, the second is like unto it. They have abrogated these two commandments. We've seen it with this great teaching here by the brother. And others here are going to come. But we see they've abrogated the two great commandments have been abrogated. The love of God and the love of your neighbor have been twisted in to the love of self. And then the second into an ecumenical voice.
Yes.
Love your, it's a universal thing.
Right.
Amen. And it displaces God with self, and it displaces love for our neighbor, true love for our neighbor, with a sort of tolerance and a worldview that brings in everything, all encompassing. And so men, amen, great men of God knew this to be true, to know God. George Mueller, men like David Brainerd, Hudson Taylor, amen, men like Adoniram Judson, William Booth, Charles Finney, D.L. Moody, amen, Jonathan Edwards, we think of the list goes on and on. John Wesley, one of my favorite, amen, preceded every revival in Wales, Great Awakenings, Azusa Street, even the book of Acts, where they prayed, they found who God was.
Yeah.
They knew their master. Amen. Amen. If I sound like I'm excited.
Amen.
Do I love my master enough to obey him? To jettison all worldly things, all sins, all weights. I've seen men use the pulpit to cover their sin.
Come on now.
I've seen men use the pulpit. Amen. That pulpit might be a street corner. Listen now. That pulpit might be a street corner.
Yeah.
Or a campus bench. Amen. Or another venue. You know, we rationalize. It's my work. My work outweighs my lack of submission to him.
All right.
Huh? Yeah. Do I love my master? Is he everything to you? Is he everything to you? Amen. Can he touch every area? Israel rejected this. Israel rejected God. Amen. And he was trying to put his word into their heart, as he's trying to do us. Israel rejected this. The apostate, lukewarm churches of our postmodern day are filled with this. Amen. And we will not is the mantra of the church world for the most part today. We will not have this man to rule over us.
You're right.
All right? I don't claim to have apprehended this now. I don't claim to have arrived, but 12 years and a few things, and you know, you get a household of 10. We've seen God provide for us. He's made a way. Amen. As we have submitted and obeyed. Amen. Except you become as a little child.
Yeah.
A little child. Submitted. Well, we don't like that. Well, we better like it, mm-hmm. because he said it. Mm-hmm. And it's to be obeyed. And in Exodus 21, pierce my ear. That's what we're talking about here tonight. Pierce my ear. Amen. Look at this real quickly. Matthew 6 and 24 to read this, but just we'll read here. He said, man cannot serve two masters.
That's right.
Right.
He'll either serve the one and hate the other, or hate the one and love the other.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot serve God and mammon. That's what mm-hmm. he said. Here, he says this. Notice the word master. Now these are the judgments which thou shalt set before them. If thou buy an Hebrew servant, 6 years shall he serve, and in the seventh he shall go out free for nothing. If he came in by himself, he shall go out by himself. If he were married, then his wife shall go out with him. If his master had given him a wife, she had borne him sons or daughters, the wife and her children shall be her masters. He shall go out by himself. And if the servant shall plainly say, I love my master. Now just hold on to that for the next few minutes. I love my master. My wife, notice the order here. I love my master. I love my wife. I love my children.
Yeah.
Notice the order. I love my master, my wife, and my children. I will not go out free. He said in verse 6, then his master shall bring him unto the judges, shall also bring him to the door, or unto the doorpost, and his master shall bore his ear through with an awl, and he shall serve him forever. Amen. It's interesting to note here in a world and a nation and a society of free thinkers, free wheelers, and all these kind of free loaders. Mm-hmm. Amen. Many, amen, where many liberties are abused and most freedoms are actually bondages, amen, and slavery, pro-choice. All, you know, I've got pro-choice and all these things we could think of, amen. We need to look at this and note that in our text here, amen, the Hebrew slave here became such, amen, as a result of either poverty or crime, amen. We see the same thing in the 21st century today. People are slaves because of a poverty of spirit or, moral crimes against God. Amen. For 6 years I serve, and the seventh year they're set free under the law. Amen. The master's was then required to make provision here from his flock, from his threshing floor, and then from his wine press so that they could begin a new life. And furthermore, if the slave had a wife before the master, they were come to the master, he set him free. If the master gave, amen, the slave a wife after, then the children and the wife were to stay, and the slave himself was set free. The masters were commanded not to rule with rigor, according to Leviticus chapter 25. They're not commanded to rule with rigor. Perhaps the reason that many of these slaves remained with their master, amen, is because they were treated well.
That's it.
They were treated very well, and the children and the wife as well. And so an affection and a bond was created between the slave and the master. It was formed there. That's important.